Following the major victory of the Conservatives in the UK and the massive defeat of the Labour Party, Brexit has finally won. I think, I mean, they voted for it, but come on, man, even with the majority, I'm skeptical. We'll see. It's been years, but we do have big breaking news. UK Parliament backs Brexit deal in decisive step toward leaving the EU on January 31st. The decision marks a significant breakthrough for Prime Minister Boris Johnson, who swept to electoral victory last week on a pledge to get Brexit done. This story from NBC News. But I have another story, which makes me worried that even with this majority, something bad might happen. Because I'll tell you what, it keeps happening, and I'm not entirely convinced it won't happen again. But let me just say, as somebody who is not British and doesn't know exactly how the people of this country feel, there is an overlap between the Brexit voter, the Trump voter, the white working class individuals who want to have their voice heard, who are tired of being smeared and called racist and all of those things. Some of those people may be bad people, but to overwhelmingly generalize all of these people results in an overwhelming defeat for your party. This is now, as I understand it, the second definitive vote saying get Brexit done. Maybe we'll see it. Let's read the news, but then I want to rain on your parade because I think there's rocky waters ahead. But I must admit, I think we are seeing the home stretch. This is the final stretch. They're coming to the finish line. I think they're going to get it. NBC News reports British lawmakers on Friday finally voted to back a plan to withdraw from the European Union. Prime Minister Boris Johnson's bill, backed by a huge parliamentary majority, will take the country out of the 28-member bloc on January 31st and lays the groundwork for sweeping foreign and trade policy shifts. The 358 to 234 vote marks a significant breakthrough for Johnson, who stormed to electoral victory last week on a pledge to get Brexit done. The former mayor of London won the largest conservative majority since Margaret Thatcher in 1987, confirming his position as prime minister after he took over from Theresa May in July. You know what's really crazy about what happened in the UK? Look, I know I'll defer to Sargon, all right, if you guys watch Sargon's content, because he's from there, he knows better than me. But my understanding is that there were districts that were liberal, like leftist, for like 100 years that voted conservative because of how messed up everything is. And I'll tell you this, Brexit may have been the linchpin to get Brexit done, was the big push, and people were finally sick of the process and just do it. But I'll tell you this. You didn't just give Boris Johnson a path towards Brexit. You gave the Conservative Party a majority for other conservative policies. And now they're apparently putting forward, you know, economic plans. And so far it looks like the markets and the British pound to US dollar, it's actually doing really well. Well, let's keep reading. NBC News reports, Johnson's majority of 80 seats in the House of Commons meant he was able to pass the Withdrawal Agreement Bill, legislation that will implement the divorce deal hammered out with the European Union. Britain joined the EU, the European Economic Community, a precursor to the EU, in 1973. His predecessor, May, failed on three occasions to win support for a deal she had agreed with the EU, leading her to resign earlier this year. In October, Johnson was forced to break his own do-or-die deadline to lead Britain out of the bloc after lawmakers rejected his proposed timetable to get the Withdrawal Agreement Bill through Parliament, meaning he had to request a Brexit extension from European leaders. Now, here's where things get murky. Okay, first, you saw what they just said. Johnson was like, we're going to do or die. It's going to happen. And then other lawmakers rejected his timetable and it got pushed back. He was forced to go and ask for an extension. And because of that, the idea was he was then going to call for a general election, which they won. Now, meaning many of these people who blocked that Brexit may be gone. And again, I'll defer to the people in the UK, probably know better, but there's already op-eds popping up. And this could just be the remnants of the resistance trying to stop Brexit, saying that they're not going to be able to get this trade deal done. And it's going to be really, really bad. And then they're going to be beholden to the US. But I got to say, hey, as an American, I think the cousins across the pond, us American bros and men and women, will do right by the UK if they want a trade deal with us. I think that makes sense, right? Let's read on the bill. Dubbed WAB by Brexit watchers, commits Britain to leave the European Union on January 31st and to conclude trade talks with the bloc by the end of 2020. The final stages of ratification will take place after Christmas. However, this should not be confused with the end of Brexit, as we are only nearing the end of stage one. And this is where I want everyone, listen, I'm not telling you, like, I think there's some pitfalls to Brexit. I'm not British. I don't know. I'm just saying, if the people say they want it, you probably should just do it, okay? For better or for worse, my position has always been, you can rag on Trump all day and night, but I'll tell you this, the guy won, and people wanted him to win, and they get to live with his decisions, good or bad. Brexit is the same thing. But I'll tell you this now, it's the end of stage one. So I'm gonna rain on your parade, I guess. If you're someone who's really, really into Brexit, you happen to live over there, or you're an American who wants to see it get done, I'm telling you, man, there's a lot of time. And I think what we see Boris Johnson doing, get out of the EU by the 31st, and then start negotiating trade, was the smart move. Because if they tried to play it like they would get a trade agreement before leaving, it would never, never happen. And that's the complaint I'll pull up in a second. They say much of the angst over Brexit since Britain voted to leave the European Union in June 2016 has centered on the divorce itself. With that endorsed by Parliament Friday, the UK must now pivot to negotiating what Brexit will actually look like for citizens and businesses alike. First, the United Kingdom will enter a transition period that lasts until December 2020, in which it will continue to act like a member of the European Union. In the meantime, top of the agenda is defining the nature of Britain's future relationship with the European Union post-divorce. And there it is. Nothing's gonna change for a year. And I'll tell you this, man. How much do you wanna bet? And I'm warning you, you might think I'm crazy, but we just had a general election. Look, I'm not a legal expert. I'm not a British citizen. But I'm worried there will be another flip. There will be another, you know, something bad will happen. Someone, like, look, they voted for Brexit over 3 years ago and they can't get it done. It's been a back and forth, up, down, left, right. If you rest on your laurels now as a Brexit supporter, if you're like, we did it, Johnson's in, we're done, I'm gonna go home. Nah, you're gonna lose. They're gonna take it away from you. I do not believe this is the end. Even NBC News is saying, don't confuse us for the end of Brexit, because as much as they're saying we'll be out by the 31st, they're going to act like a member until 2020. What happens if they can't negotiate a trade deal? What happens then if you see a mounting effort by the Labour Party? They get rid of Corbyn, who's unpopular and deeply anti-Semitic, apparently. And they find someone who's more moderate and more popular who wants to remain. And then they start playing games. I just don't believe it. I really don't. I think, you know what, man? I listened to a speech by Nigel Farage and I was really impressed. Did you know that the UK has a House of Lords? I didn't understand this. I thought it was like the House and the Senate. No, it turns out the House of Lords are like appointees of like landowners from historic times. Maybe I'm wrong, but that's my general understanding. And I was talking to, I think it was like Sargon and Dankula, and they were like, yep. So Nigel Farage had abolished the House of Lords. And I'm like, how have you not? Wow, being governed by old money, like literally it's like we're nobles, so we're in charge. Nah, I don't play that. I'm an American. In America, you could be from the gutter, you could be a bartender from New York and become a congressperson. Yes, I respect AOC for making that leap. That's what America's all about. I can criticize her for being ignorant, naive and all that, but I love the fact that in America, you can be a bartender, you can be a working class Joe and say, I'm coming in, I'm taking you guys down, and no, we're not gonna be subjected to, you know, historical money and lords. I must admit though, the system falls in that direction no matter what we do anyway, right? Senators are all super wealthy, you know, we have legacy politicians, I get it. But at least, it's not built that way. And we have some safeguards, you know. You can see people come from modest means. The American dream is a real thing. So Nigel Farage also talked about a constitution. And I think that's one of the biggest problems I've seen. As somebody who doesn't know a whole lot about how the UK works, I'm generally confused when they're like, oh, it's a new government. Oh, we're switching. Now we're gonna have a general election. I'm like, the US is much more rigid than that. You know, we know when our elections are gonna be, we know what our rights are and they're essentially immutable. I mean, I say essentially because it's really, really hard to get rid of a constitutional right. You know, we have amended and gotten rid of some things, like prohibition was taken away. I think that was put in the constitution, right? Anyway, our government is based on a founding document. UK doesn't have that. So, and there's a lot of countries that don't. Let's read a little bit more and then I'll bring you to the worrying news. They say by most accounts, 11 months to strike a trade deal is ambitious, but Johnson has insisted that he won't agree to any more delays. The pledge has set off alarm bells among businesses who fear Britain could crash out of the European Union with no future trade arrangement in place at the beginning of 2021. A no-deal Brexit is widely considered a nightmare scenario, raising the possibility of shortages of food and medicine, civil unrest, and conflicts in Northern Ireland. But I tell you this, I think Trump wants a symbolic victory. So you may have heard about Jeff Van Drew, for those that are American who are watching. He's a Democrat who is now flipping to become a Republican. It's a huge risk, but I think the Republicans are gonna protect him. You know why? They want the symbolic victory of proving they've defeated the left. If Jeff Van Drew is voted out, it would only make Republicans look weak or disloyal. So I think Trump's going to get behind Van Drew. I think he's going to say he was a smart man, he's a moderate, and we respect his voice even though we disagree. And Republicans are going to support that to prove a point. Not only that, a lot of Republicans are probably moderate too, disagree with Van Drew on certain issues. But here's the point. Donald Trump has every reason to strike a trade deal with the UK before the end of 2020, even as soon as possible. And they've been talking about it. Apparently there's some fake news about the US like interfering with their National Health Service or whatever. Apparently that's fake news and it's like propaganda or something. I have no idea. The point is, think about the symbolic victory of Trump talking about, you know, nationalism and fair trade agreements. And you know, you have the USMCA, which even Nancy Pelosi says was fantastic. Donald Trump then steps up, goes to Boris Johnson and says, don't worry about it. We got your back. You voted to leave the EU and we'll make sure that vote stands. Donald Trump, populist right. Brexit, a populist right-wing movement. Boris Johnson is the same thing. Babylon Bee, a satirical website, ran a joke article saying, Labor, you know, Labor voters shocked, you know, cry or scream after seeing Boris Johnson pull off mask to reveal he's actually Donald Trump. The point is, if Trump wants to make an example of the defeat of these leftist policies and positions, he needs to make sure the UK doesn't face food shortages, civil unrest, etc. The UK is going to face civil unrest no matter what, as will the US. But I think this is a big opportunity for Trump to say, if you want to take care of yourself, we got your back, but it's your country. You want to leave the EU? Congratulations, you did it. Your people voted, so be it. Now we'll negotiate a trade deal with you guys. Trump will claim another major victory on a fair trade deal that's good for both countries, make sure the UK doesn't collapse. And interestingly, creates this strange, you know, historical inversion where the colonies were once under the jurisdiction of the crown, and now the crown is seeking assistance, a trade deal from the United States. So it creates like a really balancing factor. Now I get it, a lot of people will say the US came and saved the UK 100 years ago, you know, with World War II and stuff. No, I know it's funny, but it's like, we used to be, you know, under the crown, and now it's the crown coming to the US and us being like, we got your back, you know what I mean? So it's funny stuff. But let me give you a little bit more, because I wanna make sure with this historic vote for Brexit, you make sure you stay vigilant, diligent. Another Brexit crisis next year is almost guaranteed from the Irish Times. Trade experts are unanimous. There is no time for a major EU trade deal before December. And this is why I talked about Trump and his symbolic victory and why he would want to have a trade deal with the UK, to prove a point, to claim he's winning, and that will really rally his base. People in the UK will be really rallied by that. Look, a lot of Brexit voters, they like Trump too. But if you think the Labour Party and the left are going to back down in the face of Brexit, you're sorely mistaken. Donald Trump won the presidency and we have dealt with nothing but years of psychosis, okay? They refuse to accept it. They hate the man so much. They tried to impeach him. And in fact, they didn't actually even impeach him. I'll get to that in the next segment at 4 p.m. But I tell you this, this is the budding crisis that you will start hearing about moving forward to make sure Brexit does not happen. Trade experts are unanimous. There will not be a time for a major EU trade deal. You're gonna get all these people, working class people too, concerned. Is the economy gonna tank? Are we gonna have shortages of food, water, medicine? What's gonna happen? We really need that trade deal. And then when they start, you know, hammering, oh, the economy's gonna crash and they're gonna do the recession line, there's gonna be massive outrage. This is the fuel, this is the seed being planted to make sure that Brexit doesn't move forward. It's the last ditch effort of the left, or it's their mounting resistance. It's not over and it'll never be over. The ends don't justify the means, because you will never meet the ends. Perhaps Brexit will actually happen January 31st, but as you saw, they're gonna act like members of the EU until December 2020, so basically another year. That's a long time for people to try and do something. Granted, I understand there'll be a formal, you know, they will formally leave the EU on the 31st. I guess if you like Brexit, you better cross your fingers, because there have been so many blocks and delays, who knows what will happen. But I'll tell you this, my prediction for what's gonna happen with the UK is Trump is gonna swoop in with a very, very UK favoring trade deal. I think there'll be a trade deal that will heavily favor the UK, absolutely. I don't think it will be bad for the US, but I think it will be slightly better for the UK. The reason is, like I stated, they want the symbolic victory. They need to make sure the UK proves that their populist movement works. So if Trump does a trade deal with them that hurts the UK and they struggle, that proves it doesn't work. And it proves that voting in this direction is bad across the board. Leaving the EU and not getting a trade deal with the EU, if that's true, will be bad for many people in the UK. I also think it's fair to point out too, however, you can think of the trade arrangements as kind of an addiction. You know, you're getting all this food and medicine and stuff from the EU, so you become less self-reliant. You start, you know, working with trade partners. The way Trump has worked things has brought jobs back. I mean, Detroit's bringing in 3,000 new jobs. Apple is now going to start manufacturing products in the United States. I think there may be some hardship, but the general idea is that even without a trade deal at all, Britain needs to make sure it's self-reliant and they can handle their own food stores and their own medicine. Because if they can't produce it on their own, I mean, they're in trouble. But again, here's my prediction and I'll wrap it up here. I think Trump is going to come in with a very, very favorable deal for the EU. I'm sorry, not the EU, for the UK, to make that point and be like, wow, look how well they're doing. You tired of winning yet? That's going to be the play. I could be wrong. We'll see what happens. But I'll leave with one final note. If you are someone who likes Brexit and you sit back and kick your feet up, don't be surprised if they pull out from underneath you. This has been delayed for 3 years. Don't think the fight is over. Even NBC News is saying it's not over yet. Stick around. Next segment's coming up at 4 p.m. YouTube.com/TimCast. It is a different channel, and I will see you all there.